So next, I am going to discuss the special cases in elastic one-dimensional collisions. So in the previous class, I have discussed the expressions for final velocities for the two colliding bodies in the case of one-dimensional elastic collision. So as I discuss here, if M1 and M2 are the mass of the two colliding bodies and U1 and U2 are the initial velocities of M1 and M2 just before collision, then in the case of one-dimensional elastic collision, as we have, I have discussed the derivation, V1 equal M1 minus M2 by M1 plus M2 into U1 plus 2M2 by M1 plus M2 into U2, and V2 equal to 2M1 by M1 plus M2 into U1 plus M2 minus M1 by M1 plus M2 into U2. I have discussed the derivation of these expressions. Now we are going to discuss special cases in head-on elastic collisions. Head-on means one-dimensional. So coming to the first special case one, suppose if the two colliding bodies have same mass, that means M2 equal M1, then you can substitute M2 equal M1 in this equation, in each one of these two equations. So you get V1 equal to, if you substitute M2 equal M1, the M1 minus M2 becomes 0. Then in the second equation, if you substitute M2 equal to M1 on the right hand side in the second term, you get V1 equal to U2. That means the final velocity of M1 just after collision is same as the initial velocity of M2 just before the collision. And V2 equal to two M1 by M1 plus M2, M2 is equal to M1 here, into U1, plus if you substitute M2 equal to M1, on the right hand side, even in the second equation, then M1 minus M2 becomes, M1 minus M1, that becomes 0. So this term will vanish, or you get V2 equal to U1. 2m1 by 2m1 becomes 1. That means if the two colliding masses in the one-dimensional elastic collision have same mass, then the final velocity of m1 just after collision is same as the initial velocity of m2 just before collision. And final velocity of m2 just after collision is same as the initial velocity of m1 just before collision. That means if the two colliding bodies have same mass, then their velocities will be exchanged or interchanged after collision. If U1 and U2 denote the velocities of M1 and M2 before collision and just after collision, then final velocities will be VU2 and U1. That means the velocities of the two colliding bodies will be interchanged after collision. Because the mass are equal, you can say that momenta, linear momenta of the two colliding bodies get interchanged after the collision. And you can even say that the kinetic energies will be interchanged after the collision, because the mass of the two colliding bodies are equal. So in general, in the case of one-dimensional elastic collision, if the two colliding bodies have same mass, then their velocities will be exchanged or interchanged after the collision. Now you just concentrate only to listen to me. Don't write running notes now. I will be showing the notes for the special cases later. So coming to the second special case 2. Suppose if the initial last second body is 0. Then you get V1 equal to M1 minus M2 by M1 plus M2 into U1. And the second term containing U2 will vanish. The second term containing U2 will become 0. And V2 will be equal to 2M1 by M1 plus M2 into U1. The second term containing initial velocity U2 becomes 0. That means second body is initial at rest, then the final velocities of M1 and M2 just after collision respectively are given by V1 equal M1 minus M2 by M1 plus M2 into U1 and V2 equal to M1 by M1 plus M2 into U1. So there are number of questions you find given in different books and even some standard books and previous exam papers to find the fractional decrease in the kinetic energy of the colliding particle which is transferred to second particle. So when the second particle is initially at rest, initial kinetic energy of second particle is 0. But the collision is elastic, total kinetic energy of the two colliding masses remains constant. But that means kinetic energy of M2 increases after collision, which means kinetic energy of M1 will decrease by the same amount. Because some of the kinetic energies of M1 and M2 just after collision is same as some of the initial kinetic energies of the two masses just before collision. So what the decrease in the kinetic energy of M1 will be transferred to the M2, or increase in kinetic energy gained by M2 will be equal to decrease in kinetic energy of M1 in this case. So from this equation you can write V1 by U1 equal to M1 minus M2 by M1 plus M2. So let K of denote the final kinetic energy of M1 just after collision. Ki denote the initial kinetic energy of M1 just before collision. So Kf equal to half M1 V1 square, Ki equal to half M1 U1 square. Don't mistake that Kf has the total final kinetic energy of the two colliding masses. Total final kinetic energy of the two colliding masses just after collision is always same as the total initial kinetic energy of the two colliding masses before collision when the collision is perfectly elastic. Here Ki is initial kinetic energy of the first mass M1 just before collision. Kf is the final kinetic energy of same mass M1 just after collision. So this will be V1 by U1 whole square. You can substitute here V1 by U1 equal to M1 minus M2 by M1 plus M2. So don't write running notes when I am explaining. I will be showing you the notes separately, then you can copy. At present you just concentrate only to listen. So M1 minus M2 by M1 plus M2 whole square. So decrease in the kinetic energy of M1 will be equal to Ki minus Kf. So fractional decrease in the kinetic energy of the mass M1 The fractional decrease in the kinetic energy of the mass M1 which is transferred to M2 is equal to actual decrease in the kinetic energy of M1 that we can write Ki minus Kf divided by initial kinetic energy of M1 this you can write it as ki by ki minus kf by ki. So ki by ki you can write as 1, kf by ki you can write m1 minus m2y, m1 plus m2 whole square. So you get this as m1 plus m2 whole square minus of m1 minus m2 whole square by m1 plus m2 whole square. As you studied in lower classes about simple formula, a plus b whole square minus a minus b whole square is 4ab. So using that result, you can write it as 4m1 m2 by m1 plus m2 whole square. So fractional decrease in the kinetic energy of the first mass m1 in the case of one-dimensional elastic collision, which gets transferred to second mass m2. If the second mass m2 is originally at rest, is equal to 4m1 m2 by m1 plus m2 whole square. So if the initial law, we are continuing the discussion of same case 2. If the initial law of the second body is 0, in the case of one dimensional elastic collision, then fractional decrease in the kinetic energy of the mass m1 which is transferred to m2 will be equal to 4m1 m2 by m1 plus m2 whole square. In good number of problems, you are given the ratio of the two masses. Suppose if m2 is n times m1, the mass of second mass m2 is n times m1, then you can substitute here m2 equal to n into m1 by m1 plus m2 is n into m1. This you can simplify it. You get 4n m1 square by 1 plus n whole square into m1 square. That means fractional decrease in the kinetic energy of the mass m1 which gets transferred to m2 will be 4n by n plus 1 whole square. For example, the mass of the second body is 4 times the mass of the first body, for example. Then you can take n as 4. Then fractional decrease in the kinetic energy of m1 will be 4n by n plus 1 whole square. Will be 4 into 4 by 4 plus 1 whole square, means 16 by 25, of 64 by 100. That means the kinetic energy of m1 will decrease by 64%, which is transferred to m2. So in the same way, sometimes you may be given m1 as n times m2. If m1 is n times m2, that means instead of m2 equal n times m1, if you are given m1 as n times m2, then fractional decrease in, you need not copy this part, I will show you the notes separately. So just concentrate only to listen. Then fractional decrease in the kinetic energy of m1 equal to 4 into m1 m2 by m1 plus m2 whole square. So in this equation, we can now substitute. Suppose m1 equal to n into m2. So you get 4n m2 square by n plus 1 whole square into m2 square. That will be again 4n by n plus 1 whole square. That means in the case of one dimensional elastic collision, if one of the colliding bodies is initial at rest and mass of one of the colliding bodies is n times the mass of other colliding body, and fractional decrease in the kinetic energy of the particle which is initial in motion due to the elastic collision, which is transferred to other particle, is 4n by n plus 1 whole square. So maximum possible transfer of kinetic energy, let us denote this fraction by small f. The fractional decrease in the kinetic energy is less than or equal to 1. So the maximum value of this fraction will be 1. For example, if m2 is 4 times m1, we get fractional decrease in kinetic energy of m1 as 16 by 25. That means 16 by 25th part of the initial kinetic energy of m1 is transferred to m2 after collision in this example. But this fraction cannot be more than 1. At the maximum, it will be equal to 1. That means the maximum possible transfer of kinetic energy takes place from m1 to m2 when 4n by n plus 1 whole square is 1, or n plus 1 whole square equal to 4n, or n plus 1 whole square minus 4n equal to 0, or n minus 1 whole square is 0, or n minus 1 is 0, or n equal to 1. N will be equal to 1 when m1 and m2 are equal. That means if the second particle is initially at rest, I mean in the case of course my present discussion will be completely about one dimensional elastic collisions. The second particle is initially at rest and first particle is in motion before the collision, and the collision is one dimensional elastic, then maximum possible transfer of kinetic energy takes place from m1 to m2 after the collision if the masses of the two colliding bodies are exactly equal. If m2 is equal to m1, then maximum possible transfer of kinetic energy takes place from m1 to m2. As already discussed in the previous case, that if the two colliding masses in the case of one dimensional collision are equal, then their velocities will be exchanged after the collision. That means in the case 1, we have discussed that if m2 equal to m1, then v1 equal to u2 and v2 equal to u1. So in case 1, we have discussed that if the masses of the two colliding bodies in the case of one dimensional elastic collision are equal, then v1 equal to u2 and v2 equal to u1. Now that means we are considering the situation where combination of both cases, that means if m2 equal to m1 and u2 is 0, then using the above conclusion, if u2 is 0, v1 will be 0 and v2 equal to u1. That means in the case of one dimensional elastic collision, if the second body which is initially at rest has same mass as the first body which is initially in motion before the collision, then after the collision, V1 becomes 0. That means the first mass m1 will come to rest after the collision. And v2 equal to e1. That means the second mass m2 will start moving with the original velocity of m1. That means the linear momentum of m1 is completely transferred to m2 after collision in this case. Even the kinetic energy of m1 is completely transferred to m2 after collision in this case. That means in this case, fractional decrease in the kinetic energy of m1 is 1. Or percentage decrease in the kinetic energy of m1 is 100%. So the total kinetic energy and momentum of the in each first mass m1 is completely transferred to second mass m2 after collision in this case. This theory of elastic collisions is used for selection of the moderator in a nuclear reactor. Of course, you will be discussed about the term moderator in nuclear physics in the second year syllabus. But even you might have heard this term moderator even in the school textbooks. So moderator is a material used to slow down the fast neutrons released by fission process in a nuclear reactor. That means the nuclear reactor, the speeds of the fast neutrons released in the fission process are reduced due to the elastic collisions with the nuclei of the moderator. The speeds of the fast neutrons will be reduced due to the elastic collisions with the nuclei of the moderator. So we have to select the moderator in such a way so that the speeds of neutrons can be reduced effectively. That means the masses of the nuclei of the moderator must be comparable to the masses of the fast neutrons which collide with the nuclei of the moderator. That means we should not use heavier nuclei as moderator. Because if a heavier nuclei are used as moderator, the fast neutron will rebound back almost with the same speed in the case of one-dimensional elastic collision. So, for example, some of the nuclear reactors, heavy water, D2O, is used as moderator. The nucleus of deuterium, suppose if M1 is the mass of the fast neutron, need not copy all this discussion, it is just to listen. I will show you the notes separately. The fast neutron makes a head-on elastic collision with a stationary deuterium nucleus whose mass is approximately 2 times the mass of the neutron. Then using the result of the case 2, if M2 is n times M1 and U2 is 0, then the fractional decrease in the kinetic energy of M1 which is transferred to M2 is 4n by n plus 1 whole square. That is, here n is 2, 4 into 2 by 2 plus 1 whole square, or 8 by 9. That means 8 by 9th neutron loses 8 by 9th part of its initial kinetic energy after collision. So 8 by 9 is into 100%. That is little more than 88%. That means the neutron loses almost 88% of its initial kinetic energy after the collision. Or 88% of initial kinetic energy neutron is almost transferred to the deuterium nucleus after collision. That means the theory of elastic collisions is useful in selection of the moderator used in nuclear reactor. So coming to the next special case, suppose if the in U2 is 0 and the mass of second body which is initially at rest is extremely large compared to the mass M1 of the first body, then we write V1 equal to M1 minus M2 by, as I discussed in the previous case, that means this case 3 is again again a case, special case of previous case 2. That means as we have discussed in the previous case, initial offset second board is 0. Then V1, in the case of one-dimensional elastic collision, of course present discussion is only about one-dimensional elastic collisions. U2 is 0, then V1 equal to M1 minus M2 by M1 plus M2 into U1, and V2 equal to 2M1 by M1 plus M2 into U1. So here M2 is very, very large compared to M1. So you can neglect M1 compared to M2 in both numerator and denominator in the two equations. Then you get V1 to be almost equal to minus U1. And if M2 is negligible, I'm sorry, if M1 is negligible compared to M2, then V2 becomes negligibly small compared to U1. That means I try to show it roughly by a diagram. The mass M1, the lighter mass M1, makes a head-on elastic collision with a stationary mass M2, which is very large compared to the first mass M1. This is the situation before collision. Then after collision, you get V1 equal to minus U1. That means after the collision, the first mass M1 will rebound back almost with the same speed. That means direction of velocity is reversed, but magnitude of velocity almost remains same. But second mass M2 practically continues to be at rest. That means if a lighter mass M1, which is in motion, makes a head-on elastic collision with a stationary mass M2, which is very, very large compared to the lighter mass, then after collision, the lighter mass rebounds back almost with the same speed, but the heavier mass practically remains at rest. For example, if a rubber ball is dropped from a certain height on a smooth horizontal elastic surface, and suppose if the collision between the ball and the floor or surface is elastic, then after collision the ball rebounds back almost with the same speed, but the surface with which the ball collides, the floor or the surface or body with which the ball collides, that practically continues to be at rest. So next we are going to discuss an opposite case to this. So next I am going to discuss a case similar to the, converse of the previous case. Here the second mass M2 is initially at rest, and mass M2 is supposed much less than M1. That means the mass of the second particle, which is initial at rest, is negligibly small compared to the mass of first particle. As we have seen in case 2, if U2 is 0, then V1 equal to M1 minus M2 by M1 plus M2 into U1, and V2 equal to 2M1 by M1 plus M2 into U1. So if the mass M2 of second particle is negligibly small compared to the mass M1 of the first particle, then you can neglect M2 compared to M1 in both the equations. So in the first equation, if you neglect M2 compared to M1 in both numerator and denominator, you get V1 to be nearly equal to U1. And if you neglect M2 compared to M1 in the second equation, and the expression for V2, you get V2 to be nearly equal to 2U1. That means this is the situation I have shown here before collision. So after the collision, the first mass M1 continues to move almost the same speed in the same direction. But the second particle, which was initially at rest, will start running twice faster than the first particle. That means if the mass of the, in the case of undamaged large collision, second mass which is initial at rest, if the mass of second body which is initial at rest is negligibly small compared to the mass of first body, then after the collision, the first body continues to move in the same direction almost with the same velocity. But the second mass which was originally at rest will start running twice faster than the first body. There was one question originally given, one of the very old IIT entrance exam papers. Now also a similar question is given in the engineering entrance in Andhra Pradesh, that a body whose mass is more than 1 kg sphere or body which is whose mass more than 1 kg is moving with a velocity of 2 meter per second, makes a head-on elastic collision with a stationary ping pong ball whose mass is about 1 gram. And you are asked to find velocity of ping pong ball after collision, assuming the collision to be elastic and one dimensional. So mass M2 can observe 1 gram is much less than 1 kg. Then you can apply the conclusion here. V2 is nearly 2 times U1. If U1 is 2 meter per second, V2 will be 4 meter per second. So now you get ready with your notebook and pen. I'm going to show you the notes for the special cases. So I'm going to summarize the discussion about the special case in head-on elastic collision. That means I'm going to show you the notes for the same which I have discussed in this class. That is, I am going to show you the notes for special case in head-on elastic collisions. Those who are writing the notes, come on. Get ready with your notebook and pen. You can start writing now. I am going to show you the notes. That means for the special cases which I have just now discussed. In case you need more time to copy the notes, wherever required, you can take a pause and copy the notes. Case 1, if M1 equal to M2, then V1 equal to U2 and V2 equal to U1. So in a one-dimensional elastic collision, if the two colliding bodies have the same mass, then their velocities will be interchanged or exchanged after the collision. Come on, copy down this. So in case you need more time to copy this, you can take a pause and take your time. In case 2, coming to the case 2, if U2 is 0, then V1 equal to M1 minus M2 by M1 plus M2 into U1. And V2 equal to 2M1 by M1 plus M2 whole multiplied by U1. So from the first equation, can write V1 by U1 equal M1 minus M2 by M1 plus M2. That means we are trying to find the ratio V1 by U1 for calculation of fractional decrease in the kinetic energy of M1. Fractional decrease in kinetic energy of M1 which is transferred to M2. Come on, all of you, first finish copying the notes up to this step, so that I can show you the continuation for this. In case you need more time to copy the notes, you can take a pause and take your time. So fractional decrease in kinetic energy of M1, which is transferred to M2, can be written as equal to actual decrease in kinetic energy of M1 divided by initial kinetic energy of M1. Actual decrease in the kinetic energy of M1 is equal to initial kinetic energy of M1 minus final kinetic energy of M1. Initial kinetic energy of M1 just before collision is half M1 U1 square. Final kinetic energy of M1 just after collision is half M1 V1 square. So actual decrease in the kinetic energy of M1 will be equal to half M1 U1 square minus half M1 V1 square divided by initial kinetic energy of M1, that is half M1 U1 square. That gives you the fractional decrease in the kinetic energy of M1. Can divide each term separately here. This you can write this way. So you get 1 minus V1 by U1 whole square. Earlier I have discussed that V1 by U1 can be written as M1 minus M2 by M1 plus M2. Come on, first all of you finish copying up to here. First all of you must finish copying up to here so that I can show the continuation for this. So in case you need more time to copy this, you can take a pause and take your time. I am going to show the continuation for this. That will be equal to M1 plus M2 whole square minus M1 minus M2 whole square by M1 plus M2 whole square, which you can write 4M1 M2 by M1 plus M2 whole square. That means fractional decrease in kinetic energy of M1, which is transferred to M2, can be written as 4M1 M2 by M1 plus M2 whole square. If M2 is n times M1, first you finish copying up to here so that I can show the no continuation for this. In case you need more time to copy this, you can take a pause and take your time. So if M2 is n times M1, then the fraction decrease in the kinetic energy of M1, 4M1 M2 by M1 plus M2 whole square, M2 have substituted NM1. So that will be 4M1 square N by M1 square and N plus 1 whole square, or 4N by N plus 1 whole square. If M1 is N times M2 and U2 is 0, then fractional decrease in kinetic energy of M1 is equal to using the same formula 4M1 M2 by M1 plus M2. That means if you take M1 equal to N times M2, then also you get F equal to, I mean fractional decrease in the kinetic energy of M1, which is transferred to M2 due to elastic collision, elastic one-dimensional collision, is 4N by N plus 1 whole square. Come on, all of you finish copying the notes up to here. In case you need more time to copy the notes, you can take a pause and take your own time. I am going to show the notes continuation for to this. If U2 is 0 and M1 equal to N times M2, or M2 is N times M1, I am showing the conclusion here of this case. Then fractional decrease in the kinetic energy of M1, which is transferred to M2, is 4N by N plus 1 whole square. Maximum possible transfer of kinetic energy takes place from M1 to M2 when 4N by N plus 1 whole square is 1, or 4N equal N plus 1 whole square. First you finish writing up to here. So you can take a pause and copy the notes up to here now. Next I would like to show the continuation to this. 4N by N plus equal to N plus 1 whole square. Same thing can be done as N plus 1 whole square minus 4N equal to 0, or N minus 1 whole square is 0. So N minus 1 is 0, or N equal to 1, or M2 equal to 1. That means in the case of one dimensional elastic collision, the second body is initial at rest. The maximum possible transfer of kinetic energy takes place from M1 to M2 after collision if M2 is equal to M1. So if M2 equal to M1 and U2 is 0, then V1 equal to U2, that means the combination of both the cases 1 and 2, which I discussed earlier, is 0, and V2 equal to U1. That means in the case of one dimensional elastic collision, before collision, second mass is at rest, first mass is in motion. Then after collision, the first mass m1 comes to rest and second mass starts moving with the velocity u1, with the original velocity of m1 before collision. So v1 is 0, v2 equal to e1. That means the kinetic energy and momentum of the first mass m1 gets completely transferred to m2 after collision in this case. I mean when second mass m2 is initial at rest and has same mass as that of the first mass m1. So in the case of one dimensional elastic collision, the two colliding masses have same mass, then their velocities will be exchanged or interchanged after collision. That means if the second mass m2, which is initial at rest and has same mass as that of first one, then after collision first one which was originally in motion will come to rest. And second one which was originally at rest starts moving with the original velocity of first body. Come on, finish copying the notes up to here. In case you need more time to copy this, you can take a pause and take your time. So in head-on elastic collision, if the second body which is initial at rest has same mass as that of the first body, then after the collision, the first body comes to rest and second body starts moving with initial loss to the first body. Come on, those who are writing the notes, first take a pause and copy this conclusion, which is used in some of the questions. Next, I am going to show the continuation to this, notes for the continuation. Case 3, if u2 is 0 and m2 is very, very large compared to m1, then v1 equal m1 minus m2 by m1 plus m2 into u1. Here, if you neglect m1 compared to m2, we get v1 equal to minus u1. Come on, that means this is the figure shown on the right side, shows the situation before collision. You can take a pause and complete writing the notes up to here. I am going to show the notes continuation to this. So I get v2 equal to 2m1 by m1 plus m2 into u1. So if m1 is negligible compared to m2, then you get v2 equal to 0. That means the second mass m2, which is initial at rest, has very large mass compared to the first particle which is in motion in the case of one dimensional elastic collision. Then after collision, first particle rebounds back, moves back in the opposite direction with same speed, but second mass practically continues to be at rest. So in case you are still copying, you can take a pause and copy this. I am going to show the notes continuation to this. One more special case, case 4, if u2 is 0 and m2 is very, very small compared to m1, then in the equation v1 equal m1 minus m2 by m1 plus m2 u1, you can neglect m2 compared to m1, that you get v1 to be nearly equal to u1. And v2 equal to m1 by m1 plus m2 into u1. If you neglect m2 compared to m1, you get v2 to be nearly 2u1. Come on, finish copying the notes up to here. In case you need more time to copy these notes, you can take a pause and copy the notes. So in my next class, I will be discussing one problem in elastic one-dimensional collisions. Then I will be discussing about one-dimensional inelastic collisions.